So, okay, so I'm going to describe how we build this ERLIT, this Educational Resource Index. And our, I think our motto at the Training Coordinating Center is to use data science to teach data science. So we are supposed to be teaching data science to biomedical researchers, which use data science techniques to in our own work. Just a quick overview, you've seen some of the people, the information science team that are here, maybe Jonathan Gali and Christina will join us later. And there's a number of PhD students and master students that have worked with this in our team. So B2K founded the Training Coding Center. You've seen some of the slides of how it looks at the website. You're going to go to the website a little bit more. And you can, right now, if you go to the website, you can search, and we will give you relevant resources from our database. But our goal is not just to provide a search interface, but to create under the hood a knowledge map. And we were inspired by the Khan's Academy knowledge map. I don't know if you're familiar with this, but the Khan Academy has all these videos from mostly K-12 and sometimes videos into undergraduate education. And they manually organize this beautiful map in which they organize all the, food, all the dependencies of all the videos. But it is all manually, it's a labor of love and it's a great resource, but we want to do all these type of things automatically. So our goal at the B2K Training Quality Center is to identify high quality training resources, describe them, organize them, and provide personalized training paths, and doing as much of this automatically as we can.
Sorry, can I interrupt?
Sure.
So how do you define high quality?
So it's subjective.
Minimum standards?
Let me answer in a pragmatic way. Okay. First, we identify good sources. So obviously, the materials being provided with the B2K centers, we consider them high quality. We have a bias towards kind of videos and massive online courses, so those are fairly high quality. The courses from Coursera, Udacity, edX, now from university professors, reputable places. Then we've gone through this automatic exercise of identifying, so we have tutorials, keynote talks on scientific conferences. Those can be obtained from different places on the web. We've been looking at video lectures of them and directly in YouTube. And in YouTube, and maybe answering your question more precisely, we actually had this exercise of identifying high quality videos from YouTube. And this is somehow, I guess, subjective, but we went manually, created a training set, and then we're training machine learning algorithms to identify these videos. And our criteria for high quality was, it was a bit subjective, but I mean, it's the person giving the talk from a reputable university, a well-known researcher, is in a series of a conference series, something has embedded a peer review in some farm. So it's not, at this point, deeper than that, but I think that's enough for our purposes. Everything that we find automatically then is reviewed by human curators. So Anish is doing some of these, other people are doing some of that. So every time that we find something automatically, we still have a human revise the resource to verify that it's indeed high quality. But high quality is a fuzzy concept. So there's another person in the Training Quality Center who's not here, Rochelle Trachtenberg, which is more of an educational specialist. And he probably can give you a longer answer of what it means for material to be high quality, that's really achieve the skills they're supposed to teach, and so on. But taking a fairly pragmatic definition of high quality.
And related to that, can any material be indexed, or it has to be of certain format?
We had a bias initially towards video, meaning that we want the MOOC courses, the videos, tutorials, keynotes from conferences, that type of material, so video-based material.
Yeah.
And we put a little bit of the written materials in the back corner, but we also got the written materials and have experience of identifying written materials, but they have to be didactic value. So we look at books, we look at some scientific papers that have more overview of tutorial, but our major focus so far has been on kind of video content. we think that has more didactic kind of value. But there hasn't, yeah, it's more of a purpose at this point, is where we put our initial emphasis. And you'll see where the data comes from in a minute. Okay, so the first step is to identify the high quality training resources. So these are about heuristically identified, but by finding repeatable sources and then searching wide sources like YouTube and filtering them to solve criteria. The other major effort is how to describe and organize these resources. So we've been spent quite a bit of effort on mathematically modeling the resources, so assigning concepts from our ontology that we define on data science, so we can categorize each of the learning resources using machine learning and visual techniques, and also how to organize the resources, so what depends on what, and that's kind of ongoing work. And then finally, our ultimate goal is to provide this personalized training path for our user learning goal. So as users come to the website, this will express a learning goal, we have a small model of the user, and we'll see where those two connect. So what are the different kind of materials you have to go through to go from where you are to where you want to go. And we've done some small work on user modeling, and we were building a recommendation engine as we get more users in the website. Our recommendation engine right now is based on this data. The searches of the users, so it's a simpler path. Okay, so let me just let you know what we're doing, what we've done so far. So we've spent quite a lot of work extracting data from the resources, so we don't develop the resources ourselves, we're just indexing and collecting and taking pointers to existing materials. In order to do that, again, we do scrape, essentially, existing resources. If they don't have an existing API, we will go ahead and scrape them. And this is the type of resources that we will create. So here's an interaction with the statistics from Udacity, and there's our course title, the description of the course, if it's free or not, things like a syllabus, sometimes you have prerequisites that are explicitly given, most often they're not. And you have the instructor and affiliations of instructors and things like that. That would be Udacity. In other sites like video lectures, you have a talk by Jeff Dean from Google on deep learning. And here they will have not only the video, but also the slides linked to them. So we will get all this metadata, like the title, the description, but if that's material like transcripts of the video, we will get that. If there are slides, we will get them. Because we're trying to collect as much text, essentially, as much data we can of each of the resources, so we can apply machine learning on top of that text. So we built a scraper system in Python that's available as a Docker image, and we use that to basically scrape quickly additional sources. So this is one of the critical slides if you want the whole talk. So this is our current DB. And for some people that have seen this talk, this slide keeps changing. It's the same slide, but the data keeps changing. So this is what we have right now in the database. It's about 9,000 resources, 9,100. Here you see the sources. We have data from BD2K, or parts of BD2K, the big books, exclusive Udacity, lots from video lectures, only the parts that have to do with data science. Again, we have this data science focus. Elixir has a broader scope, and other organizations have a broader scope. We really are looking at these kind of data science related resources. We had some small scraping from YouTube, and you should expect a lot more to come from YouTube. We are very grateful to Elixir that they have shared the data with us, and we will share our data back with you, as we will discuss later, and different other sites. And this is what is right now. You go to the website, you can search for these 9,000 plus resources, and very, very...
There's a big cutoff there at the bottom. I can't hear it.
Sorry.
Oh, you shouldn't have touched it.
I shouldn't have touched it.
No.
How would it happen? Okay. Anyway.
What happened. Something like that.
Anyway, very soon we'll get over 10,000. So we already have 10,000 resources that we have collected. These ones here, they're in green. They are waiting for human verification of the automatically assigned tags. So we have to put them just in the index because we want to make sure that that everything has been verified by human to ensure the high quality, albeit it's subjective, and we'll get toward 10,000. And where we have 10,000, this will swap in the size. Just across the whole database. And as you see, I mean, we have 10,000 resources. That's a lot of work if we want to do things manually. So a lot of our effort has been trying to do a modeling automatically. So the current modeling or the current description of resources, in addition to the metadata that we extract from the providers, has been to assign essentially concepts to these resources, concepts relevant to data science. And we define this concept of dark taxonomy. And the way this taxonomy was developed was also in a semi-automatic fashion. So this kind of concept model is something we call the data science education ontology, ontology of data science, has these six graphical dimensions, about 120 concepts. And they were identified based on our own domain knowledge, on noun phrase extraction from all the data that we got. So we have all this text material, the descriptions, the courses, the transcripts, the slides. So we run NLP processing on that, starting noun phrases, key phrases. We also run topic models, and that's how we're going to do it more detail. And that's how we generated this particular ontology. And originally, we had generated a much bigger ontology, but we kind of scoped it down so that we can automatically learn these concepts. And I'll give you a little more detail about that. And if you want to read the ontology, it's public, it's available in the bio portal, in the National Center for Biomedical Ontologies. So the dimensions that we looked at are what are the steps, what is the data science process, what are the stages of the data science process which results we're helping with. Is it about data extraction, data integration, data analytics, data visualization, things like that. Most of the concepts have to do with the domain, so what is the area of the study that we're focused on. It's about deep learning, it's about a clustering method, it's about neuroscience, topics like that. What type of data, so neuroimaging, genetics. These numbers are the number of concepts that we have in each category. Programming tool, programming core tool. This is just a highlight of some common tools. So people really like Python or R or Hadoop or Spark. So we have a highlight of some very common tools using data science, and we want to make sure we tag them because that's, again, some arbitrary list of tags, but well, sorry, has to do with the popularity of the tools right now. But if we have many more, but we're trying to keep it small. And then what kind of format we have, is it video, is it written materials, is it advanced or interactive. And you can go to our website, you can read this, but if you go to the website, you can see our ontology presented in a nice graphical fashion. Thanks to Sumiku. And how we develop this ontology. So, we have this criteria. So first, do we already have at least five resources for proposed tags? So initially we have a lot more concepts, but we bring it down because first we want to make sure we have enough support for this concept. Also the concepts or these tags are useful. It's something that won't be found if you search using information retrieval techniques on the description. So does it capture some concept that isn't obvious from the text? Does it help find the user, does it help the user to find the right data? Do have a clear definition of what this concept is. And last but not least is like we really want to learn these tags automatically. So we want to attach these tags to the resources automatically. So do we think that we can actually automatically predict these tags? And of course, right now we have this about 120 concepts, and we have identified many more. And I'll tell you some of the techniques where we should identify these concepts right now. So we have a queue system in which we have the tags that are kind of part of the ontology right now, and then tags that we think will become part of the ontology as we accrue more resources and they become more relevant. So this is our way of kind of doing ontology evolution and extend this vocabulary. So how did we, what were some of the automatic techniques we used to describe, to identify these concepts? So we run topic models, different types of topic modeling algorithms, LDA, well known. We use a slightly different version. Another topic modeling algorithm called non-negative matrix factorization, fancy state latent variables. But these topics can be represented as word palettes, and these are the kind of things that we find. So after we run the topic models over all the text that we have. So we identify, well, deep learning is really important concepts, big data, genomic data, neural networks, social media, business analytics. So these workouts help us to figure out what are the important concepts in the domain. And we will add them. If we didn't have them already in our ontology, we will add them by essentially inspecting the topic models. This was our pipeline to find the topic models. You can, when you have the topic vectors over all the data, you can cluster the resources. This is what Jack was referring to. So we cluster all the resources that we have, and you can see there's a structure there. I don't think you can read that, but if you hover over this data set, you see there's a bunch of machine learning courses or lectures in a little point here. And this is actually inspired of earlier work that was done at NIH, which colleague, which here was part of, in which they took all the NIH grants and ran topic models of them, and then you get a clustering of the grants. So here you see grants about cognitive neuroscience, and here is about infectious diseases. So you get this kind of clustering. I'm going to get in such a clean breakup because they're all related for data science, but you do see that different structure here. And this is kind of useful, and we may put this presentation on the website at some point. And then how we use this, so this is a typical type of data that we have. This is a class called Introduction to Reinforcement Learning, from ASM Learning. We had assigned some tags to it manually. We did some manual work here. Like reinforcement learning, probability statistics, and then you run the topics, and we see that the major topics are, again, reinforcement learning and bias and inference. So let's see that our tags, manual tags, were reasonably accurate, so that confirms the sticks in tags. But for all the other resources, here are sequential Monte Carlo methods. Again, these were tags that were assigned manually initially. We look at the topics, and here you see that the more interesting topics come out from Monte Carlo chain, Markov chain, optimization, and then we will essentially, so topic models suggest additional tags, and then we will consider them. If we have enough data that supports these tags, we will add them to the ontology, or we'll just put in the queue waiting for additional resources to support these tags. Okay, so now we have a set of ontology in which we can tag, give good descriptions of these learning resources. But we cannot really do all these manually. We have 10,000 resources, we don't have enough people and humans to really tag everything manually, so we need to do automatic tagging. And we've explored a number of approaches with machine learning, with retrieval. I'll show you the results here. We essentially extract text from the resources, process the text, moving the stop words, sustaining, things like that, vectorize at the Notago boards using TF-IDF, and then we tried a number of classifiers to assign each of these 120 tags. And we tried a number of different learning approaches. And these are overall results for training. So we have like two setups. One, if you place each of these 120 resources, 120 tags by themselves, and one in which we take into account the hierarchy. Because if something is tagged as deep learning, it's also machine learning, it's also computer science. And here you can see kind of our best performance is about 73% F1 score for the exact tag. And if you take the hierarchy, you get more information. So this is not perfect, but it's good enough to do initial filtering, initial assignment of tags, and have the humans review the results. We've done recently more precise experiments in which we broke the performance by the different dimensions of our ontology, and here we can get a little bit of an extra performance boost for main. And here we did a hyperparameter search by different machine learning algorithms. Here you can see some of the best agreed results for each of the dimensions. So this is the overall F1. This is the F1 when we have more than 15 resources for a given tag. So if we have enough support, not surprisingly, we get better results. So we will go from 0.76 to 0.18. So here you see we are at the 0.80, 0.77. For some things we predicted quite well, 0.98, 0.70. And there's a couple of dimensions in which we are lagging, and we're working on improving these results. So finally, we've done quite a bit of work on creating a schema to share our training resources. So Elixir had shared some of the data with us. And we want to also share back with the community, Elixir and everybody else. So we've worked hard on designing a schema for those resources. We reviewed all the existing kind of learning resource schemas that existed, learning core, different things, LRMI, the learning community meta model, schema road, and so on. And created our own ontology. Then in parallel, Elixir, our groups were doing this, with Elixir via schemas. So we spent a lot of work was trying to align both our ontology with Elixir via schemas. And Elixir in particular had a preference to express everything in schema.org. The reason schema.org is supported by Google and with large search engines. And this will help you get indexed by Google better, so it will help the materials being found easily. So we also participated actually in the schema.org course extension of our web working group. That's kind of now part of the schema.org. And we are generating link data based on the descriptions of all our metadata and embedded into the pages, and we also will provide it as an API or a file for other people to reuse our data and give it the maximum kind of dissemination possible. This is a screenshot of the alignment. We had a working meeting with Niall in the last couple of days, and we went through this in detail, so I think we're pretty close to an agreement of exactly what the alignment is and be able to reuse the specific tags. We have a common core, then we decided some other some properties and classes that may only appear in Elixir or in VLW, but the common core with this schema or vocabulary that should be widely acceptable by many people. And then what we want to do with that is that every single page will have this structure metadata in it so that you can reuse or disseminate or propagate our work. And our work will include, I mean, includes everything that we structure from the websites, but also our own additional tags and this type of information. So what, that's more or less what we've been up to. I'll give you some additional details on currently ongoing work. So we really saw that we've got a number of data from YouTube, a few hundred videos, but those are really the videos that we looked at kind of manually because we need some training data to train our classifiers. But they're really the big onslaught, hopefully, of high quality resources will become fairly soon because we are running this large experiment in which we search YouTube for all kind of data science related terms. In this experiment, we run about 62 queries. We scraped the first 20 pages of YouTube. So we have right now 40,000 videos from YouTube in which we extracted the title of the video, the provider, the person who posted it, the likes, all kind of information, the transcript that we have, if it's available. So all the text that comes in that video. So 40,000, about 35,000 of them are unique because the same video may be reachable through different searches. We've gone through this non-trivial manual process of looking at almost 1,000 videos in which some humans, so somehow subjective, we thought, okay, this is a really great video, it's in YouTube, but it's a really great data science video, this would be useful for somebody to learn a specific topic in data science, or no, this is kind of sounds like data science, but it's like really not either high quality, some kind of random person saying about data science will save the world, or something that is not high quality. And we've simply trained machine learning algorithms over our data set. So we trained these videos with this kind of scale of 0 to 4, so 0 being helpful, but not really high quality, and 4 being helpful. We can binarize this in our first experiment, saying, well, if 0.1 is low quality, if it's 2+ is good quality, and that was based on kind of some heuristics. But the critical thing is that we were able to train machine learning algorithms, and we got a prediction accuracy of about 83%. Meaning that we were able to predict which one of the high quality videos, 83%. So on our kind of initial training or manually, of all the standard, no? Our resource that we updated manually. So what we are actually going on through right now, if you want to apply this classifier, we want to do a bit more research on classification, try to improve these numbers. But after that, we'll go with 40,000 videos and truly find out how many of those are high quality or not. And that may put, I don't know at this point how many additional videos we'll get, but it could be on the thousands of additional videos that we can get. It's still high quality videos. And the process will be automatic identification. We will pass the ones that are classified as high quality to human curators. They will vet that video, say, yeah, this is high quality, it looks like this. It's a video from Stanford Plus, and it sounds like great. So we also assign additional tags with these automatic methods. And what does pass the human curator, then you go into an index. We have also some ongoing work on identifying dependencies between the learning resources. And for that, we've been mining a lot of the existing sources of dependency information, which are the tables of contents from books. Some humans have already told you, you should learn this particular topic in this particular order. And that's the way you structure a book or you structure a class. So we're mining this to identify dependencies between resources. What is the space going to come? So that's the final slide, summary. So the next step, we're incorporating automatically additional learning resources. We have this large scale effort on YouTube. As was mentioned before, so we still like the scientific literature. People still learn from books and papers before there were video and MOOCs and so on. So we have a parallel effort on extracting high quality content from the scientific literature. Again, it has to be still at the right level, so it's not something didactic. If you go very, very deep into some topic, then you're going to be at the edge of the starting, at the edge of some research. It's not clear that it's going to make it. So that may be too far to push in this particular effort. And there's some previous work that's done, in which work Dali and Jonathan were involved on extracting and finding reading lists from particular topics, from the biomedical literature, called Technic, or Technic Hack. And we will keep adding the resources from D2K as they appear. So there are BC, almost, I think 15 centers or so that are basically using the training materials. We are collecting as much content as we can from this resource, so transcript and slides. When we have a video, if it doesn't have a transcript, we will run a speech recognition. So Jonathan was pretty busy doing that and getting additional video. There's a question still of how useful the text from speech recognition or the text translations of PDF slides, forward slides is going to be because of error on translation. So sometimes you get lots of text, but the quality of that text may be less quality than if you have a description of the course or whatever it might be. And it has to do with what kind of artifacts of the PDF to the text or the speech recognition. So speech recognition does pretty well like in news type of speech, but if you have a very technical term, that's probably the one that the speech recognition is not going to recognize properly, and that will be the one that's most informative to really tell you what the topic's about. So we're doing it, but the jury's still out there how useful overall this will be in improving our test scores. But we want to make sure it's test done. Again, there's a human curator interface that is a web-based interface that we've developed in which we human curators can go and validate the automatically created tags. At some point we're using it internally. There's a question if we would maybe open it up to Amazon Mechanical Turk and get kind of reviews from the public, and also we get information from the website as people use the website more. So this is I defined the prerequisites. That's a big effort. We've been trying a number of things. The personalization, as we get more users on the website, we will collect database and the usage on the website, the trails that they pick, which resources they put in their learning paths, in their clusters of resources, and we will use that to recommend the resources. And Christina Lerman, which I'm not sure if you make it here or not, and have defense today, but see if you work on that. So that's it. This is my talk. mandatory in this light. That's sort of view from my office, and I thank you.
Are there any questions for the panel?
Yes. Yes.
So do you just surf the web to find training material, or you go to some known resources like EBI or TESS or some other places to find training resources?
So we've done both things. So we, in our initial set of collection, we identified what we thought were high quality sources. So I'm a fan of the MOOCs, so I know that Coursera has great courses. Okay? So if you want to learn machine learning, do take Andrew Mann's machine learning course. It's a great course. Okay, so we had some understanding of which sources had high quality content, and we focused on those first. Then we just went to the open web, and we started with YouTube, because a lot of organizations, they put their seminars and all kind of materials on YouTube directly. So that's what we now. And as I say one thing, so Google, so I just, when you type something in Google, you type data science and YouTube, you get lots of videos of, you know, data science and machine learning, super vector machines, whatever term you're looking for. Google is trying to do the best job they can of giving you the most relevant videos for that. So we're kind of piggybacking on Google. Google already has a lot of effort on topic modeling and ranking to give you relevant videos. However, we're not even to take that, because if you retype any of these strings in Google, you get thousands and thousands and millions of hits. So we're going to this additional filtering using our sense of what a good video is, or a good high quality video. And again, we're using machine learning, so we are telling the system how to do this. The system is kind of finding. But informally, the criteria is okay, is this a video by a reputable kind of person? Is this somebody who's an expert in industry, or is a professor in university? Things that we do, I mean, I said that we are scraping all this data from YouTube, so we get the descriptions, but we do more things. We actually take the descriptions of the courses, and we run name entity recognition to find out if there are mentions of people or institutions in that description. So if it says that, this is a talk by Professor Eng from Stanford, we will pick up Stanford and Professor Eng. Things that we've tried is to actually go and see if those people identified in the videos have a Google Scholar profile. So it's a feature in machine learning. So just because somebody has a Google Scholar profile or gets some hits in DBLP, we don't know if it's a high quality video, but that goes into machine learning. And then we went, because we went to do machine learning, again, we really want to do it manually. I guess tag those almost 1,000 videos, and then let the machine learning figure out what's the best combination of all these features to predict. Right now, in the current version, we get about this 80% F1, which is pretty good, I think. And we're trying a few more methods before we kind of roll this out at scale. I mean, we already collected these 40,000 videos, but before we kind of go through all that, we're trying refining the machine learning.
And I'd be curious to know if you picked up any material from Australia. Like, I'm not sure of videos, but there's heaps of written training material that
actually
exists.
I know there's some, I think maybe didn't we get some. So from the manual, so again, this is manual identification. We have this large queue of materials. Okay, what you've seen is the things that are stored on the table, so it's actually in the index right now. But every time that any of us or some friends or some people at the workshop tell us, okay, we have a great technical resources, they send us an email and we put it in a queue. And that doesn't mean that we'll index it maybe tomorrow, but it's in our queue, it's registered, and we will get there.
Yeah.
We're balancing how much kind of manual work we do from people that tell us, okay, this is a great resource, already has training materials, versus how much we find in the open web. And we've done an effort right now on the YouTube effort of really trying to find things open. And again, the other effort is going to literature. So we had this strong bias, I guess I had this strong bias, and I'm sure maybe all. I have a strong bias for the video, okay, but again, written materials are absolutely great, and we have two experts, Paul Galli and Jonathan, that have worked on written materials from the literature, and we will probably expand our collection of written materials.
A little bit, just add a little bit for that. What we're doing is, at the moment, we're looking at Google Books, and they have a fairly API textbooks. Abstracts and titles. So, and of course, it's like that taps into the large scale infrastructure do have available, we can categorize those and the maps and look at the, actually maybe we can integrate those with videos as well.
That's a pretty modern, I think that you make explicit. I didn't only have some bias for video, but have some bias for things being free. So we really focus on things that are freely available. Of course, there's a lot of high quality content behind some type of paywall, but we actually kind of push down on the queue. I'm not saying that we want to index those, but certainly we're trying to get all the free high quality material first, as opposed to say, okay, you can buy this book, and it's still a great book, or you can take this course that is a master class in a particular university that will be several $1,000. So we actually kind of push those down in the queue. So video on free.
So I'm glad that we're having really good discussions, but I don't want to get us too far off track in terms of our time. We will have some time this afternoon to further have some discussions. Please hang on to your questions. And again, but Terry's next. I don't want to interrupt Terry by interrupting yourself. Terry, did you have one quick question?
She seemed to have a question. She was like,
well, yes.
Really quick.
That's right. You're like very bright. You said, yeah, I'm looking at the sun that came out, so you have this glow around your halo. I don't know how to do it.
I was just kind of following up on this general thing. You mentioned also incorporating data from B2K grantees. Do you actually have a process for doing that? I ask because I know this has been an issue for buy-in from the literacy perspective. How do you get the nodes to buy into and propagate their materials through tests? Do you have the same?
So maybe this is, again, a personal bias. So we really went, we said, okay, there's already a lot of existing materials. So the process has been somehow, so we know when people are putting materials. We have seminars, we talk to all these people. So they let us know when they have materials, new materials being developed. And that has been somehow slow. I think most of the materials have been starting like this summer, I guess. I would say, or maybe a little bit earlier, in the past summer. So in this year is when most materials have been coming. We haven't defined a prescriptive process. I think we like some of the ideas that Elixir had. We could basically tell the providers, so now we have a schema. So now we have a schema in which we have the metadata of the resources. Something that we thought of is say to each of the B2K grantees is like, well, don't just put a web page with random text on your website about this particular learning resource. Put that page anywhere you like it, but include this little snippet, the structural data, this JSON or this snippet. So now we have the schema, we can tell them, okay, this is a snippet you should include. We haven't been very prescriptive about it. We don't necessarily have the power to tell them, but you can enlist NIH to give us the power to tell each of the centers, you must put this snippet if you want to be indexed on Erudite. But we haven't really been pushing that much that idea. I mean, I think it's still a good idea. I think that's a bit how Elixir works. And I like it. We talk about doing this, which is providing a website in which the B2K grantees can register their resources. And as they fill out a form, what they get as output is the JSON of the snippet, so they don't have to really create it themselves, and they can grab that and put it on the page. We have provided a lot of tooling at this point, or kind of strong direction to the other B2K centers.
The social engineering behind all this is something that is, you know, again, you can lead a horse, right? And go and provide them with everything they need, and you know, they'll still find some reason not to do it. Your wisdom on how you do this in the Elixir test would be awesome to get a vision on.
Well, I mean, this is the guru who can speak to that at some point. But, so one of the reasons I brought it up is not just from an Elixir perspective. I was quite surprised the other day to receive an email from the International Society for Bio Curation announcing that they were making available some training materials. This struck me as really odd for two reasons. The first was the ISB and there was a goblet, and they didn't put the materials in a goblet, which would then have been surfaced through tests.
Yeah.
The second is, I looked at materials, they were B2K materials, they were from a B2K source. So why aren't they surfacing them through Erudite?
That's interesting. Yeah, that's interesting to hear about. Again, some of these things, there's some other meeting that goes on and they decide to send their stuff there and we find out about it, kind of as we get around with it, it's very odd.
I think some of the more tiny things, like they were not the main materials initially for people to educate. I think that's ramping up quite a bit later. Yeah. And I think we probably need to be more prescriptive when we talk about that problem. How prescriptive or how, I mean, how much more formalized the process.
How big of a hammer can we
use? So basically tell everybody, I mean, they're mandated to provide the data to us, but how strongly we want to report that?